So next week will be review, and then the week after will be the final exam. So, and then, yeah, this week we're covering chapter 12, linear regression. We'll go over that, and that's pretty much it for your introductory statistics course. I hope it's been satisfactory, and I hope you guys learned something, and don't hate statistics, but can appreciate it a little bit. Are there any questions about anything before we move on?
Will we see a calculation of our grades before the final?
Yes, so I will grade these quizzes and I'll enter them into the book, and then I'll send out a grade report that says if you want this grade at the end of the class, you need to get this much on your final. That's about it, right? Because the final is going to be the only thing that's left after this. I guess there's an assignment due next week, but I'm just assuming everyone's going to turn it in.
I guess one other question. When are we turning in our assignments?
What do you mean?
Our homeworks, are we going to give them to you, or?
No, you keep those.
Okay. So,
you just turned in the papers this quarter. I trust you guys. Okay. The other class, maybe not so much. I trust you guys, so you can use your homework to study from. And that's that. Okay. I hope the quiz wasn't too terrible. I know it took a little bit longer for some of you. The final exam will just kind of be a whole bunch of problems. We've covered quite a bit. And so it's just gonna be problem after problem after problem, kind of like this, but longer. And you'll just have to figure out what to do, figure out the hypotheses, do some calculations for the statistics and things like that.
Is it gonna be Scantron too, or is it?
Yeah, it's gonna be all Scantron. So I'll talk about the final in more detail next week. But yeah. I think it's fair. It's fair. But of course, I didn't think that. So. Okay. Any questions or issues from stuff from last week or weeks before? Okay. All right. Then we will finish off with the last topic. This is chapter 12, and we're going to do linear regression. So linear regression this is used when we are looking to see if there is a relationship between two numeric variables. So far, we have done categorical variable as the explanatory variable and a numeric response. And then we had, so that was t-tests and also ANOVA, categorical explanatory variable and a numeric response. And then the chi-squared tests were categorical, either categorical variable by itself or is there a relationship between two categorical variables. Okay. With linear regression, we have two numeric variables, and we want to know, is there a relationship between them? So just an aside, linear regression is just one aspect of the general topic of regression in general. Okay, so all of regression is, I've got numeric variables as explanatory variables and a numeric response. Okay, and we want to see if there's a relationship between them. So linear regression, we just take one numeric variable, one numeric response, and we are looking for a linear relationship, meaning a straight line relationship. This is the most basic form of regression, and this is where we all start. And that's all we're going to cover in our class, is linear regression. It's the most basic form of regression, similar to one-way ANOVA is the most basic form of ANOVA. Linear regression is the most basic form of regression. You can take an entire class on all sorts of more complicated regression. The book kind of glosses, does just like a very, very brief summary of some more complicated regression methods in the last section of chapter 12. And it just kind of does example or just describes situations where they might be used. But that's beyond the scope of our course. Okay, so linear regression. For straight line relationships. So, the idea is you have an x variable and a y variable, okay? So the example in the book is we're looking at one species of snake. And we measure how long the snake is, and we measure how heavy the snake is. Okay, so we're saying if there's a relationship between the length of a snake and the weight of a snake. Okay, and this is all for one species of snake, and so we'll definitely see a relationship. Okay, because snakes are pretty much, it's like rope, and so if you have a longer snake, it's gonna weigh more than a shorter snake, right? So. It's like cutting different lengths of rope, but they're snakes. Okay, so we got the length, and we have the weight. So in our case, length is the explanatory variable. Sometimes it's called the independent variable. Weight would be the response or the dependent variable. Okay. Y being the response and X being the explanatory. Okay, and so these are the values that that they have. This is table 222. I'm sorry, 12.2.2, and it says we have a snake that's 60 centimeters long, so that's like 2 feet long, and it weighed 136 grams, and another snake that was 69 centimeters weighed 198, 66, 194, 4, weight 93, etc., etc., etc. Okay. So we want to know, is there a relationship? Okay. Well, the most basic tool is creating a scatter plot. And we would graph the x variable over here and the y variable here. And so this is just like plotting coordinate pairs that you probably did in like 8th grade or 10th grade or something like that. So let me just get find the appropriate range. 55 to 70, okay. 55, 60, 60. Vertical 100 to 200. Not the most precise scale, but okay. All right, and then so we would just go through and we'd graph them. So we'd say the first snake is length 60 and weighed 136 grams. So that's it's like right there. And the next one weighed 69 centimeters and weighed 198 grams. And then we had another one 66 centimeters weighing 194. There, and 54 weighing only 93, and okay, so we only have four dots there, and then if we add more, if I graph the other snakes, which I don't have listed there, but I plot them out here, they look kind of like this. Something like that. Okay, so does it appear there is a relationship between the length of a snake and the weight? Yes, okay. It seems quite clear that as the length of a snake increases, the weight of a snake also increases, okay? So, the weight tends to increase. Okay. A side note is, you know, I use this word increase, but that might be a little misleading because it's not that we're looking at the same snake over a period of time. Okay, we're just looking at, here we're looking at like a dozen snakes all at once, and we're just saying, oh, this snake over here is longer than this snake over here. I expect this snake over here to weigh more than this snake over here. Okay? And so it's not that when this snake grows longer, because there's not a passage of time per se, unless we're doing multiple measurements or something. It's just comparing two snakes. If I find a snake that's longer, I would expect it to weigh more than the snake that was shorter. Yeah.
Can you say as the length of snakes increases, the weight tends to increase?
Yeah, I should say as the length of snakes increases, the weight tends to increase. I don't know how best to phrase it, okay? Or maybe just we can just even more generically, we can say snakes with large x values tend to have large y values as well. And vice versa, that we have small x values, we tend to have smaller y values as well. So we create a scatter plot and we see, you know, these dots kind of in this nearly straight line fashion. And so we can say there's going to be a linear relationship. So we're going to spend a lot of time learning about this concept of correlation. But your most basic tool in terms of linear relationships or just determining if there's a relationship between x and y is going to be your scatter plot. Okay, so you should always always plot the data first if you're doing regression. Okay, so when we're describing a relationship between two numeric variables, we want to talk about, okay, so let's write this. When describing direction strength. I should say mention the form direction and strength. Okay. The form would be whether it is linear or not. Okay? I mean there are more not linear can there's more specific ones that we can use, but in our class we're just gonna, because we're only learning linear relationships, everything's either gonna be linear or not linear. Okay, so form would be linear relationship or non-linear. Again, linear means straight line. So does it seem like a straight line could work here? And then there's going to be a bunch of examples where we're not quite sure. Okay, but the other two is the direction and the strength of a relationship. So the direction can either be positive or negative. Okay, positive relationship is just like this over here. Large values of x are associated with large values of y. Small values of x are associated with small values of y. Okay. Negative relationship, just the opposite. Large values of x tend to be associated with smaller values of y. small values of x are associated with large values of y. Okay, so the relationship between length and weight of snakes is positive. Let me just think of some scenarios. And don't shout out the answers, but think whether you think the relationship is positive or negative. Time spent studying and score on an exam. Generally positive, okay? Generally, students who spend more time studying generally will score higher than those who spend very little time studying. But not always, okay? You're always gonna have exceptions, things like that. Outside temperature and ice cream sold.
What?
Ice cream sold.
The, I guess, yeah, total, I don't know, total amount of ice cream sold. Probably positive, okay? Hotter it is outside, you'll probably sell more ice cream. Colder, when it's cold outside, not a whole lot of people buy ice cream, okay? And then if we do, outside temperature and sweaters sold, probably a negative relationship, okay? High temperatures outside, probably not a lot of people buying sweaters. The opposite, low temperature outside, more people buying sweaters. Altitude and air pressure. Negative, right? High altitude is associated with lower air pressure. Lower altitude, higher air pressure. Okay. So anyway, but those may not be linear relationships, okay? But anyway, in any relationship, you can have a positive or negative thing. But then you have ones where you can't say positive or negative because it changes. So let's say, for example, speed driven and fuel efficiency. That one you're going to have this curved, kind of nearly quadratic relationship, okay? Where if you're going 0 miles per hour, you're getting 0 miles per gallon. You can go a little bit faster than that, you'll get some, not a whole lot of fuel efficiency. When you drive around 50 miles per hour, 55, that's probably when your fuel efficiency is at its max. But then when you're trying to drive like 90 miles per hour, your fuel efficiency decreases because your car is trying to overcome a lot of wind resistance and stuff. Okay, so those relationships you can't just say positive or negative. But for linear relationships, positive and negative work just fine. Because it's just a straight line, right? It's either gonna be, so positive, the dots will go in this direction. And negative, the dots will go in that direction. The steepness of the angle has nothing to do with how positive or negative. Okay, it's just, it's either positive or it's negative. The steepness is not related to that. And then on the other hand, we have the strength. Okay. The strength, from a like a visual standpoint, it's just how much or how little scatter is there, okay? How much scatter is there, okay? Lots of scatter would indicate weaker strength. Lower strength, little scatter, conceptual standpoint, the scatter, the strength of a relationship tells us how well can we predict the response based on the explanatory variable. If your predictions are going to be very close to the actual value, then you have high strength. If your predictions are not very precise, then you'll have low strength. Okay, so good predictions. Tell you if the two variables are distance ran in kilometers and distance ran in miles, then that would be perfectly strong, right? Because if you know how many kilometers someone ran, you can predict exactly how many miles that person ran, okay? There's no uncertainty there. You just multiply by, what, 1.6 something. No, I divide by 1.6 something. On the other hand, other things will not be as good predictors. So maybe the value of someone's car and the value of their dwelling. Okay, there's probably going to be a positive relationship. Generally, people who drive high-value cars will live in higher-value dwellings, and people in general who drive lower-value cars will live in lower-value dwellings. But that's not always going to be the case. Okay, how well can you predict the value of their dwelling based on their car? Kind of, but not very well. Okay, probably pretty poorly, although. You know, you would not expect somebody driving around in a, you know, a Mercedes Benz to be living in a I don't know what the right word is, but a low value dwelling. Okay, you wouldn't expect that, but there are people who do, right? So, and on the other hand, you know, somebody driving beat up car, you wouldn't expect them to live in a mansion, but they might, okay? So, anyway, that would be, that would have a lower strength, okay? You know, all the way to the point where knowing one tells you nothing about the other, and in that case you would have no relationship. So you can have, so maximum strength would be a perfect relationship where knowing one tells you exactly how much the other is, okay? And then, so you'd, I guess, you have the range, right? Perfectly strong all the way down to no strength, okay? No relationship just means, that would be like, if I know your shoe size, how well can I predict your IQ? Not at all, okay? There's no relation, but as far as I know, there's no relationship between shoe size and IQ, okay? So that would be no strength. Okay, well anyway, these are the concepts. These, both the strength and the direction can be summarized with a statistic, and that statistic is called correlation R. So just like in distributions, the center of a distribution is summarized by either the mean or the median, and the spread of a distribution is summarized by the standard deviation, or IQR, or range. The direction and strength of a relationship is summarized by the correlation. Okay, so we have correlation. Correlation, sometimes, I guess the full name is the correlation coefficient. Coefficient is just a fancy word for number. So the correlation coefficient and the symbol for it is R. Okay. Coefficient is now a little bit more commonplace in our language, partly because of episode titles of the Big Bang Theory and stuff. All right, anyway, so we've got correlation. This summarizes both the direction and strength. R can be any value between -1 and 1, okay? So R is any value between -1 and 1. The sine of R is the direction. Positive values of R would be positive direction, and negative values of R, negative direction. And then if R is close to zero, the strength is low or weak. And if R is far from zero, the strength is strong. Okay, so R close to zero means weak strength. Close to positive 1 or close to negative 1. It's stronger. And everything in between. So we have, so with the snakes, well, here, let me just, if I do, a perfectly straight line. So these dots are supposed to be exactly on this straight line. This would be R equals positive 1. Okay? Probably just R equals 1, but I'll put indicate that it's positive. Okay? And again, the slope or the steepness doesn't matter as long. As long as there is some, I don't know if that's any less steep, but as long as there's some angle to it, this is also going to have R equals 1. And then as soon as it becomes slightly angled down, R equals negative 1. Okay. What about this? This is supposed to be flat.
0.
Okay. Here R would be 0. Positive or negative tells us large values of x are associated with large values of y, or large values of x are associated with smaller values of y. In this case, any value of x is associated with the same value of y, so there's really no relationship between x and x and 1. Shoe size and number of brains. Everyone's gonna have one brain. No relationship between those two. Okay. And then, yeah, then you have everything in between. So if you have some scatter, so in this case, there's a little bit of scatter, but overall, the dots are pretty close to the line. This is probably going to be something like r is 0.9. Okay. And then, as you have more and more scatter, you'll get weaker and weaker relationships. That might be r is 0.5. I don't know. This is, I'm making up these correlation numbers, but something like that. Yeah. To the point where you have no relationship. Big feet and high IQs, people with big feet and low IQs, small feet and high IQs, small feet and low IQs, all showing up there. People with average feet and average IQs, all of those, and everyone in between. What if we have something like this? So in this situation, okay, there's clearly some kind of relationship between x and y, right? It looks like that would be the relationship, and we'd probably predict it to go that way if we had to make predictions about the future. But the thing is that correlation really only makes sense for linear data, okay? So seeing the data points here, like this, it's going to try to fit a straight line to this thing. So looking at this, it'll probably try to do something like this. And I'll say that's my best guess for a straight line relationship between x and y. And you might get something like r equals 0.6 or something, okay? A positive thing. And if you did not make a scatter plot, you just take your data and you throw it into the computer or something and say, figure out the correlation for me, it'll spit back a value. It'll say, oh, your correlation's 0.6. And you might be like, oh, okay. Well, that's great. Well, if you plot it, it'll be very clear that a straight line doesn't make sense, doesn't work for this data. Okay. So, so correlation R, the correlation coefficient, only makes sense linear relationships. Okay. It can still be calculated for any, if you get two numeric variables, you can always calculate an R. It's just that value may not be meaningful. Okay.
Can I draw a break at the peak and then say to the left that it's a positive correlation, to the right is negative? Draw two lines.
You can. You're still.
Will that be more accurate than just?
It would be more accurate, but you still don't have quite, in this case at least, you don't have a linear relationship even leading up to the peak. Okay.
But that line would be more accurate.
Yeah,
right?
It
more
would
probably.
Be more accurate, right? It would be more accurate, and that's what we do a lot of times, where things aren't linear, but they're linear enough. Okay, so like a quadratic thing looks something like this, right? So even if you're trying to approximate this with a straight line, it's not going to be that great, okay? But if you want to approximate this part with a straight line, that might be pretty good, okay? And so you might be able to get away with doing linear regression here. You know, you might even be able to get away doing it here, but your values will probably show systematic problems, okay? Because it's not linear, right? So. Yeah, the question is, you know, how accurate do you need to be in your application? So, regression is a great tool, but it's also a dangerous tool, okay, in terms of statistics, because it's like one of those things where you can learn a little bit and you feel like, oh, I can do a lot of great stuff, but it's also, you have to teach a lot of safety, right? It's like giving someone a gun, right? You can use it and do powerful things, but then it can also be dangerous. Oh, maybe a knife is a better. A knife, you can chop your onions with that. Like, it's hard to do cooking with a gun. Okay. So let's talk about calculating R. Okay. So the calculation of R is defined as the sum product of the z-score for x and the z-score for y, and then you divide by n minus 2 at the end. But, n minus 1, I'm sorry. N minus 1. We have n minus 2s in other places, and n minus 1 is in other places. So, okay. It's the. So basically, what you're doing is you're finding the z-score of x and y, and you are multiplying those two together, and then you're adding those up. Okay, a z-score tells us how many standard deviations we are away from the mean. Okay, so if the value is above the average in the x direction, it will have a positive z-score, and if it's above average in the y direction, that will have a positive z-score. And so the positive and the positive will overall contribute positive values. So let's do an example here. Okay, so let's say I have x and y, and let's go 1, 2, 3, 4. These are my values for x, and my values for y will be 2, 8, we'll put the 6 here, here. Okay, so when I graph this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 4, 6, 8. Not. mean value, so x bar would be 2.5, and my y bar is 5. Okay, so I'm going to draw dotted lines. So this line represents y bar, 5, and this line represents x bar. Okay, so we could see, you know, this value is above the average in x and y. This is above the value average in x, but below average in y, and the opposite, and below average and below average in x and y.
Why are the number different?
Huh?
On the graph, y bar is 5? Yes, okay, I'm
yes.
confused, sorry.
Right. Should be. Okay. Let me expand the z, x, and the z, y. So I have r is equal to 1 over n minus 1 sum. Alright, z score x is x minus x bar over the standard deviation of x. And over here I got y minus y bar over the standard deviation of y. So in my calculations, I'm going to do x minus x bar and y minus y bar. And then I will do, over here, I will do the product of x minus x bar and y minus y bar. So I'm just basically going to get the numerator here. Okay. And we can see how our values come out. Let me just do the standard deviation of y and the standard deviation of x. Okay, the standard deviation of y would be 2.582. So x minus x bar would be 1 minus 2.5. I would get negative 1.5. 2 minus 2.5 would be negative 0.5. Here I have positive 0.5. And here I have positive 1.5. And over here, I subtract the mean of y. 2 minus 5 would be negative 3. 6 minus 5 is positive 1. 4 minus 5 is negative 1. And 8 minus 5 is positive. So the product of these two numbers would be 4.5, negative 1/2, negative 1/2, and 4.5. So here my r, I'm going to just move things about. Alright, so my calculation for r is 1 over n minus 1. The sum product, I can factor out the 1 over s sub x and the 1 over s sub y, because every single value in here uses the same s sub x and s sub y. And then I multiply by x minus x bar, y minus y bar. Part okay? Alright, so I've got the x minus x bar for each point, and now I'm going to add them up. Okay, and when I do this, I get a total of 8. So my r is over n minus 1, so 1 over 3 times 1 over 1.291 times 1 over 2.582. And I think all of this multiplies out to 10. Correlation, my R is 0.8. Is that okay? All right. So we can see when we're doing this, these two values, okay, the 1, 2, which is this one right here, it's contributes a positive value to the correlation, and so does the 4, 8 point. That contributes a positive value to the correlation. These two values in the middle contribute negative values to the correlation. But because they are not as far away from the mean, their contribution is smaller. And so so overall, the positive contributions are greater than the negative contributions, so we have an overall positive correlation. Okay. Yeah.
Can you I don't see the correlation. Why the two numbers on either end contribute to the positive one? Like, can you just draw a line with the average? Too? Let me see.
I'm sorry. So.
You mentioned the first dot and.
Yeah.
And the
so
last
this,
dot.
This dot and this dot.
Uh-huh.
So we find the correlation by doing x minus x bar and y minus y bar, right? So in the x direction. This is x bar. This value is larger than x bar. So x minus x bar is positive, and y minus y bar is also positive.
Oh,
so
okay.
That's going to contribute
true.
A positive value. Over here, this value is lower than x bar and lower than y bar. So the x minus x bar is negative, and the y minus y bar is also negative. So when we multiply those two together, it contributes a positive value.
Thanks.
Right? So. So these are positive, positive, and then negative, negative. Overall, because these two are closer to the middle and these are further apart, and the ones that are farther away from the middle have what we call more leverage in determining the correlation, the overall correlation is positive. Is that all right? Okay. What if I moved this point out to here? Okay. Well, that wouldn't work because my x bar and y bar would have to would shift, so I'd have to redo everything. But if I move this guy over here and that guy over there, okay, so then my values would be 1, 2, 1, 8, and then 4, 2, 4, 8. What would the overall correlation there be?
Zero.
Right? Because here, and it doesn't even matter, technically my standard deviations would change, but that part doesn't even matter because I would have negative 1.5 and then positive 3 and then positive 1.5 and negative 3. So all of these things cancel out, and this part would end up being zero. Okay. So the contributions in the positive direction and the negative direction would all cancel each other out. We'd have a correlation of zero. So it's on the I think on the final exam I have a spot where you calculate correlation by hand, okay? And you can see it gets pretty tedious with just 4 points, okay? So it's not gonna have more than 4 or 5 data points for you to in real life though. Normally have like 100 data points or something, and nobody calculates correlation by hand. Okay, we just give it to a computer, and it runs the equation, and it will spit out correlation for you. Okay, so you can just give it to R. You can even do Excel, and it'll calculate correlation very quickly for you for many data points. Okay, and probably. Two, three, four, and 2, 6, 4, 8. Okay. This was here and here. So here, when we did this calculation, we found the correlation to be 0.8. So the question is this correlation significant or not? Okay, so we have a hypothesis test to test for the significance of correlation. Okay. So the null hypothesis is that there is no correlation between the two populations. Okay. No correlation exists between the populations of X and Y. Symbolically, this is, we write, I don't know how to, this is the Greek letter rho. Okay? So like for the t-test, you use the Greek letter mu, for the mean. This is the Greek letter rho. It looks like a p, but it's actually the Greek letter for r. So the symbol for correlation is R, but the corresponding parameter in the population is rho, not a P, okay, it's rho. And so the correlation we say is equal to zero, and then the alternative is that there is correlation, okay, that rho doesn't equal zero, or if you want to get fancy, you can say rho is greater than zero or rho is less than zero. Okay. I'll show you in a moment the how to get the test statistic and whatnot and get your p-value. What would the interpretation of the p-value in this context be, though? The test statistic is based off of the correlation that we observed, 0.8. Well, the p-value here would be, it's the probability that a set of data points would produce a correlation of 0.8 just by random chance. Okay, so we're saying if there was truly no relationship between x and y, okay, what's the probability that we draw four random points and happen to get a correlation of 0.8 or something more extreme? Okay. Or in other words, if I were to just throw four darts, like close my eyes, okay, and throw four darts at a wall, what's the probability that those four spots would have a correlation of 0.8 or something more extreme? Okay. To do a correlation test like that, you need a minimum of 3 points. Because if I only throw two darts at the wall, it will always form a straight line. Okay? Alright? So it's not meaningful to have a correlation when you only have two points, okay? And so it's only after you throw that third point or that fourth point, you know, can we start to have a meaningful conversation about, is this correlation significant or not significant? Is that okay? All right, so the statistic, test statistic. So that's the test statistic that we use, and this follows. We're going to use the t-table, the t-distribution, with degrees of freedom equal to n minus 2. Okay, again, because if you throw two darts at the wall, they will always form a straight line. So in our case, our test statistic will be 0.8 times 4 minus 2, n being the number of coordinate pairs. Okay, we have four data points, 1 minus 0.8 squared. Okay. So my test statistic. Go to my t table, 2 degrees of freedom and 1.886. That's one of those rare occasions where we have the exact critical value in the table. Okay, so we can say my tail probability is exactly 10%. This rarely happens, but. What do you know? The tail probability is equal to 10%. And because I've got a not equal sign here, I'm going to double that. So my p-value would be 20%. All right. If I had used rho is greater than 0, then I would leave my p-value as 10%. And if I had used rho is less than 0, what would my p-value be?
0.05.
It would be 90%. It's because my data goes in the opposite direction of the alternative, right? Because here, if my alternative says that rho should be less than 0, and my data is giving me r equal to 0.8, I certainly don't have data to support this alternative. But anyway, okay. I'm using rho not equal to 0, so my p-value is equal to 20%. And so what does that mean? That means we do not have enough data we don't have enough data to reject the null hypothesis. Okay. I say that so often, I don't know why. All right. To reject the null hypothesis. So that means 4 data points is not enough. 4 data points with a correlation of 0.8 is not enough to convince us that there is definitely a correlation between the populations of x and y. Okay. Just by random luck, if we pick 4 random points from 2 populations that have no correlation, we might see a correlation of 0.8. Okay. So if I said, if I picked 4 random people and I said, what's your IQ and what's your shoe size? 20% of the time, I'm going to find a correlation of 0.8 just from picking 4 people. Okay. 0.8 or something more extreme. So we would need to have more data for us to come to that conclusion. It doesn't mean that there is definitely no correlation. No, it doesn't mean that. It just means we don't have. Is that okay? All right, let's take a short break and then